Bonsoir, good evening, and welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'd first like to recognize that Manitoba Music is a settler organization based on Treaty 1 territory, the original lands of the Anishinaabeg, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dakota, and Dene people, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. I'd also like to recognize the strong Inuit community we have here in Manitoba. My name is Ashley Bienyage. I am the Indigenous Music Development Coordinator at Manitoba Music. Today, I am joined by Margaret McGuffin of Music Publishers Canada. This is the first session of the On Track Indigenous Music Business Basics series happening this month and being streamed to Facebook and YouTube. These sessions will talk about foundational business skills helping artists like you get organized and develop the tools needed to establish your music as a business. Today, we'll be talking about royalties and music registration. If you want more information on the On Track series, you can go to indigenousmusic.ca/ontrack. If you have any questions during the presentation, please let me know, and I will be sure to ask them to Margaret during the presentation. And with that, hello, Margaret.
Hello. Thanks for the invitation.
Yeah, thank you so much for being here. I'm so very excited to have you, and I've listened to your presentation on royalties in the past, and I thought it was fantastic, and I wanted to share that with all of our Indigenous music participants. So with that, I will let you begin your presentation.
That's great. I'm Margaret McGuffin. I'm the CEO of Music Publishers Canada, and we represent music publishers from across Canada who operate it's really great that this is the first session because it all starts with the song. Until you have the song, there's not going to be a performance and there's not going to be a recording. So it's a great way to start the series. And I'm going to be talking mostly about royalties related to music publishing and to your work as a songwriter. So let's get started. So we just rebranded a couple years ago and to become known as Music Publishers Canada. And as we were going through that exercise, this very obvious statement started our creative journey. And that is, there's value in a song. With Music Publishers Canada, we're here to act on behalf of our music publisher members to promote their interests and those of their songwriting partners through advocacy, which means I talk to government all the time and tell them all about songwriters and music publishers, through communication and through education sessions, just like this one. So before we get into how you get your money as a songwriter, let's just talk a little bit more about what Music Publishers Canada does. Please check out our website and all of our socials at CanMusePub. We are there to talk to government about why and how Canadian songwriters and music publishers get paid. For all of you who are songwriters and are doing this professionally, copyright's your paycheck. So while most people don't want to ever talk to me about copyright, they do want to talk about how they can get paid and make sure that we have Canada as one of the top places in the world to be a music publisher and to be a songwriter or a composer. So we've been involved in all types of work related to broadcasting, to copyright, and we're constantly doing research to learn more about the market and what's happening in the rest of the world. We're also very excited to have pushed out a series of professional development opportunities over the last 5 years. We have a Music Publishing 101 that is essentially what you're going to hear tonight, but it's a two-day program that we rolled out for the first time last June. We also were very pleased 3 years ago to launch our Women in the Studio Accelerator. If we have time, there's a little bit more information about that at the end of the presentation. And for all the emerging publishers out there, we're going to be pushing out a next-gen membership category to just try to provide more opportunities for emerging music publishers and younger members of companies to network and get the information they need to have a successful career. We're also very interested in the world abroad. Canadian songs are heard around the world, as are the scores of video games and film and television productions. And so we spend a lot of time talking to our partners around the world. You're going to see a slide a little bit that talks about the fact that for our indie companies, 79% of their revenues or their royalties come from foreign sources. So it's, you can't just live in a world that looks just at Canada. You also need to be looking at the rest of the world. And each of those markets are very different. So could I get you to start the video, Ashley?
Yes, let me do that.
I'll just give you a taste of how music publishers work with songwriters.
I describe music publishing as the spine of the music industry. We're the backbone where the artist and the song connect.
To be very clear, a music publisher is like a manager of songs. So a song is done by writers, and you have artists who perform songs. The publisher takes care of the song, who wrote the song, who did the lyrics, who did the music. So that's the job of a music publisher.
The music publisher is there as your partner. You as the songwriter own and control the vast majority of your copyright, and we only work in with a small percentage of that copyright as your partner.
Music's such an amazing thing that can transform a scene in film, TV, advertising, and make it incredibly powerful depending on the song that's used. So to have someone help usher these songs into the right places, that being a music publisher, is very valuable to artists, and they need someone in their corner that's really focused on that a lot of times.
It's amazing to be able to work with a great team to be able to get your music placed all over the world. We, you know, for the last 2 years have worked with an awesome team, Hivetown, that has helped us, you know, express our music through audiences that we would never imagine.
If you play a show, you may play a show, let's say even a really good show, and you're playing to a huge arena. It's still way less than the amount of people that's going to watch like a big movie.
Publishers obviously have a huge network of music supervisors and producers and this and that they work with. It's a good help to get the music in other spheres.
I think that sync is one part of the business, and I think that it is the part of the business that music publishers can perhaps have the most influence on, just in terms of making music available to music supervisors, pitching when it's appropriate for music supervisors, you know, looking for projects, getting artists to write together for projects. The single biggest thing that we do is actually the exporting of the writers from Canada to the US, to the UK, to France, to Germany. We spend most of our time pitching for syncs in the US, all over Europe, South America, Japan, everywhere.
So for anybody who's noticing the change of name, yes, we have changed your name. We are now Music Publishers Canada. And as I said earlier, we represent both the multinational music publishers who have offices in Canada. That would be Warner Chappell, Universal, Sony, as well as Pure Music, which is the largest independent in the world, but has been in Canada since the 1930s. And then most of our members are independent music publishers who are just based out of Canada and are really interested in bringing Canadian songs and songwriters to the world. And the one thing that a lot of people in the music industry don't understand is audiovisual is as important to us as music publishers as songs and sound recordings are. So every time you hear that song in a film or television production or in a video game or in an app, it's a music publisher who's licensed that song into that app or have been responsible for collecting the royalties related to the score of that film and television production. So just a few names of companies you may see as you work further in the music industry. There's different types of music publishers. As we were talking about, there are the majors. There's also independents. And most of the independents that we have in Canada are not aligned with a label or a music management company, although there are some that fall into that category, like Arts and Crafts and Six Shooter. Most of our companies like Day Tripper and Red Brick, they're companies that just focus on the song and the songwriter. And on the compositions by those composers. So their life is very different than that of a label or as a manager. And we often, I often think that music publishing is the best kept secret in the industry. You can talk to lots of label people and lots of managers and agents, and they know nothing about the music publishing side of the business. So I'm really happy to be here today and start this course because it really is an important part of the royalty stream that you're going to collect as a songwriter. Just also mentioning, you as a songwriter are your own first publisher. So you don't need to sign a deal to talk about publishing. As a songwriter, if you create a song, you then instantly are the songwriter as well as your own publisher, your self-publisher. And many creators decide to do this and manage their publishing for years at a time. At other points, it's the right time to bring on a publisher onto your team. And in these cases, you may choose from one of these different types of publishing companies. There's also film and TV producers who own the scores in film and television productions. And there's also production music libraries. Some of you may already be supplying music into those, and those are companies that may be owned by one of these other types of publishers or may stand on their own and provide music and songs pre-cleared. So a small documentary filmmaker or a small app developer can go and actually know exactly what music they're going to get for what price without the same type of negotiation. So it's very obvious to me, and it's very obvious to the people I work with, that songwriting is quite separate and distinct from the role of the artist and the label. But not everybody really understands that. So when I started a couple of years ago looking at this, we had SOCAN take the top 20 songs and look at how many writers there were on those 20 songs. Interestingly enough, there were 90 writers on those 20 songs. We often see a song by Drake or The Weeknd will have 12, 13 different writers and producers and beat makers on a single song. And that's important to understand that many of them are not the artist. And in the case of these 20 songs that we analyzed in 2017, 56 of the 90 writers were not the artist. So they are not names that you know, not names that you hear every day. And there, many of these songwriters are full-time songwriters. There are full-time composers, and it is an industry on its own, and it is a creative process that is quite separate from the life of a touring artist or a recording artist. So when we also then looked at the SOCAN data and the top people, and for any of you who are new to the industry, SOCAN is a very important collective management organization that you should look into as a songwriter. When they were looking at the composers and the songwriters they paid in Canada, 35% of them were non-performing songwriters. They weren't the artists. They were the people who wrote the lyrics and wrote the melody. And then 50% of the money from the top performing songwriters in Canada are audiovisual composers who are full-time composers in many cases, and you'll never know their name unless you watch the credits at the end of your favorite film. So what do we look like as an industry? I represent companies that talk about their economic impact as well as their creative output. And we've have an industry in Canada that's grown substantially in the last 17 years. When I started looking at this early in my career, about $85 million was credited to music publishers in Canada. Fast forward to 2019, and we saw that my members represent $277 million worth of revenue, and the entire music publishing industry, according to StatsCan, is about $370 million, which is really close to the size of what's happening in the label sector in Canada. So let's get down to it. We're going to start talking about where the money is. And if you're a songwriter or an aspiring music publisher, you're going to get money from a variety of different sources. I'm going to focus on the song, the songwriter, and the publisher in this presentation, but you really do also need to think about the money that's coming to you as an artist and as a label or a self-released artist. So if we're looking at the songwriter and the music publishing industry, about 58% of the money is coming from SOCAN and from SOCAN's equivalent organizations around the world. That's for the performance. So whether you're listening to a live concert, you're listening to radio, you're listening to television, or you're listening to Apple or YouTube, there's a performance that happens, and there's money collected for composers, songwriters, and publishers. But there's also copies made. So when those services or radio stations put all your music onto their hard drives, there's also copies made, and that's called a mechanical right. In the old days, it was a label would pay the publisher for the right to put out a CD or a piece of vinyl. That is where mechanical comes from. In the new digital world, it's also the licenses are needed for those companies like Apple and Spotify, and there's new deals with TikTok in the last couple of months. Every time those companies make copies, as they're either compiling the music or sending it out to the listener, there's also licenses that are being issued and money going back to songwriters and publishers. We also had a reference earlier in the video about sync. Sync is simply when there is a song that is married with a visual image, film, television, video games, that's called a sync. And generally, if there's a sound recording, there'll be two licenses that are paid, one to the label artist and one to the songwriter publisher. And in Canada, the music royalties around sync is around 15%. But then we have other miscellaneous parts of revenue. So every time you see a lyric when you're listening to your favorite service, or if there's still, if you're, any of you are in education and teaching piano, there's still that print music, and there's still money coming back to songwriters and to publishers because of that. And if you, if your cheap music is published in a book, you as the songwriter need to get paid for that publisher to have the authority to put your sheet music out. So we're going to talk about this a little bit more, but it just shows you where the money is. So let's keep going. So it's really important to note too, if you're a songwriter who suddenly songs are being heard on Spotify or YouTube, you're instantly not talking just about Canada. You need to be looking about where your money is around the world. And so for my indie publishers, once again, the number is 79% of their revenue comes from foreign sources. That means in a normal non-COVID world, I would be talking to you from Denmark or for LA, from New York. My publishers would be in Korea and Japan, and they'd be looking for homes for those songs, whether it's a re-record of Anne of Green Gables, which the Japanese customer loves, or whether it's a new song by a Canadian songwriter on a K-pop hit. That's what music publishers do on a daily basis. That's what our songwriters who are really successfully globally are doing. They're traveling the world and they're looking for co-writes and opportunities to not only have their songs recorded with them as the artist, but possibly having their songs recorded in various languages around the world with different types of genres. So I'm going to skip this one right now and we can come back to it a little later if we have time. So what does a music publisher do? And just remember, all of these things may be things you do if you've chosen not to have a publisher or it's too early in your career to have a publisher. These are still things you need to think about. So first is the administration. We're going to spend a lot of time talking about where the money is, and a music publisher is really involved in making sure that the songwriter is paid. All of those micropayments are compiled into royalty payments that make a difference. And so many of our companies are investing heavily in IT systems, in databases. They're becoming data specialists and making sure that they're finding the money in Italy, finding the money in Korea, making sure that all the different parts of the royalty flow come back into Canada and the songwriters paid. It comes from really funny sources too. So we have a company that's called Day Tripper CCS, and they represent a quite popular kids show called Paw Patrol. So every time that Paw Patrol, it's the number one kids show in the world, animated kids show in the world, every time that that show is played, whether it's in France or whether it's in Asia, the money for the songs and the compositions come back into Canada. And CCS makes sure that money comes back into Canada. But what they also do is when a toy manufacturer wants to make a stuffed animal with a Paw Patrol song being played out of the animal, they need a license. They need a mechanical license. There are greeting cards with Paw Patrol songs playing when you open them. Well, that's where the publisher steps in and makes sure that the composers and the, in this case, Spin Master, who is the publisher of those scores, they make sure that they're paid back here in Canada. We also want to talk about songwriter development. And for us, the creative side of the business is very important for some of our members. Some publishers just deal with the royalty flow. Other ones then will do other things as part of their arrangement with the songwriter. And for songwriter development, that really is taking the song and the songwriter around the world. My members are constantly traveling, taking their writers physically when they could out to song camps around the world to look for opportunities for co-writing. They have pivoted to digital and there's a lot more set up for virtual co-writes. And it's been really interesting as an organization. We would normally run one or two song camps internationally every year. And last November, we figured out the text so that we could have 54 songs written in 3 days with writers all across Canada, Nashville, LA, and New York. And I think it's a game changer. Because I think this makes it much more accessible for every songwriter to be able to go and write around the world. You don't necessarily always have to travel there. And I think that's going to be good for us in Canada. You do want to go out and share the space in a studio that your publisher sets up for you. But the opportunity not to travel all the time and be able to invest in the proper studio setup is allowing many Canadian songs to be heard that may not have been heard before. It kind of levels the playing field of the type of writers who can be out there and traveling around the world. There's also the business development side, and there's been a few references to sync. Not all publishers do this equally well. So if you're ever negotiating a publishing deal, you need to start looking at who's on the team and what they're really good at. You want to make sure that they've got the back end to do the administration. You want to make sure their creative people are, you know, really see the same vision as you do for your songs. But then there's also the questions you need to ask about who on their team is pitching sync. What kind of syncs have they got for other songwriters? Are they heard around the world? Are they pitching just in Canada? How active are they in LA with branding and ad agencies in Chicago? There's a lot of really interesting connections that can be made virtually now too, which has been a good thing. We've been doing Meet the Music Supervisors events for our members all through COVID. We've had over 350 pitch sessions. And this is maybe something that you do as a songwriter, if you don't have a publisher. And we could do a whole masterclass, I think, with Music Manitoba and that on another day. But it is a really important thing that if you think that is going to be an important part of your song career, you need to make sure that you either have the skills to do that pitching, or you're partnering with a music publisher who wants your songs heard in the same way as you want them heard. Not everybody wants them in, you know, you may not want it in a car commercial, you may not want it in an alcohol commercial, and those are all things that you negotiate up front. So before we get into the different types of revenue flow, for those of you who do decide or have the opportunity at some point to sign a publishing deal, it's important to know that there's various types of deals out there. Always get legal advice. It may be that you feel like you don't have the money at this point to get the proper legal support. Look for that legal support. Make sure you are having somebody looking at every legal contract. The standard publishing agreement in Canada with a music publisher is called a co-publishing agreement. And that essentially, in English Canada, means that the starting point in most of these deals are that the songwriter gets 75 cents on the dollar, and the publisher will then own a share of the song and get 25 cents on the dollar. These will often come with arrangements on providing funding for travel or studio setup, or advance before your royalties actually kick in. Always remember, an advance means you have to pay it back. So you need to decide if you want to be taking that money when you sign that type of deal. There's also, if you're not quite ready for that type of a co-publishing deal, there's also administration agreements, which typically have 10 to 15% of an admin fee charge to the writer. So you'll be getting 85 to 95 cents on a dollar every time you're paid. But those are generally shorter agreements. It's a good way to date a publisher before you actually get married. And there are also companies that for a flat rate will also then administer all of your songs for your worldwide royalty collections. Companies like CD Baby and Song Trust have a flat rate that you can pay. There's several different companies, so you should compare them all. It's important to understand these agreements may not include, though, the creative support and the export support and the travel that some of the other co-publishing agreements would. So this is why you all want to come here. You're embarking on your international career, and you want to make sure that you get paid. The really good thing about talking about the song side of this is it's quite easy to register your songs or your musical works and start getting paid, and start getting paid from all your international opportunities. You also need to be thinking that for many of you, you're an independent artist and you're releasing your own sound recordings. Make sure, and this is the number one tip of the day, make sure you're always getting paid for each of these three things. If I'm a songwriter and then I perform the song and then I release my own recording on Spotify or on TikTok, you need to make sure you're getting paid for all three things. Lots of people go, oh, I'm signed up with SoCan. Oh, I know about MROC, but they haven't looked at all of these parts of their life. And for many of you who are starting out, you may eventually get a label, you may eventually get a publisher, and you may have other people collecting in those areas. But at the beginning, when you're managing all of this, make sure you're not missing that portion. And so it's the number one tip I give to everybody. Go back to this slide, you know, every few months and say, have I got paid for the song? Have I got paid for the performance? And have I been paid for the sound recording? So here's a good cheat sheet too. I'm not going to be covering off the performer and the label side of this, but some good names of collective management organizations should take a look at. And on the labor and performance side, really important to understand you're not getting paid through these organizations for the DSPs, the digital service providers, like Spotify, like TikTok, like YouTube. So you have to make sure that you also are adding a digital aggregator to your list of places that you're getting the money. I'm just going to park that for now, but it's an important thing to understand. Let's say you're a member of a band, you're a performer, you own the master with a band. One person in the band may have put signed up with a digital aggregator, may have had that the plays on Spotify, but you're not getting paid. You need to go back to that initial person in the band who put it up on Spotify and find out who's getting paid for that. And there then needs to be the proper split of royalties between all the performers and musicians on the recording. Once again, we're going to focus on the song, but it's an important area that is a completely separate webinar that I'm sure you'll be hearing about as you go through the program. Okay, so we're going to get paid for the song, we're going to get paid for the performer's performance, and we're going to be paid for the sound recording. We need to look at the song in more detail. So if you remember earlier in the presentation, we talked about the different types of royalties related to publishing and to you, your payment as a songwriter. And so there's the reproduction, the synchronization, which is that putting the song into film, television, and video games, and there's the performance. So for the reproduction, you get paid every time a vinyl album is released. You will get paid for the digital service providers like Spotify and Apple and now TikTok There are also payments from radio stations in Canada, not in the US, but in Canada. And there also is payments in some cases from television stations every time a copy is made. There's also background music, not so much now that we're not hearing the music in bars and in restaurants, but once we return to that world, that there's companies that make compilations for those retail stores and the restaurants, and they're paying royalties to you as a songwriter. And then we look at sync. Important thing to understand that when your music is put into film or television or a video game, that money does not flow through one of the collective management organizations. Your label, or if you're your own, your publisher, or you as a songwriter, if you don't have a publisher, needs to do those deals yourself. Make sure you're, once again, trying to talk to a lawyer, or at least a manager or another songwriter who's had experience in these sync licenses. The worst thing is to lowball and not get enough money. It's that balance of when do you worry about not getting the sync, when do you worry about not getting enough money for that sync? General rule of thumb is if there is a payment for a song, there's an equal payment for the sound recording. So then we go to the performance. And I'm hoping everybody here is already registered as a member of SOCAN if you're a songwriter. It's really important to make sure that you're registered with SOCAN. The really good thing on the SOCAN side of the performance royalties is that once you sign up with SOCAN and you register your songs with them, you will get paid for Canada, but you also will get paid for performances around the world. So that's much easier than your life as an artist or as a label. I think we've got great collective management organizations in Canada, and SOCAN does a great job of collecting for you and increasing the amount of money they're finding in foreign territories for you. On the reproduction side, you can sign up with SOCAN or with CMRA, and both have options of signing up for the world. This wasn't true a few months ago. It's a new offering by CMRA, but we now have a picture where you can sign up with SOCAN and with CMRA and sign up for the world, and they will take care of your royalties. It's a fortunate place to be in as a songwriter. If you have a publisher, your publisher will help you collect the reproduction royalties and some of the performance royalties. Your publisher may also decide not to collect everything centrally out of Canada and may have partners around the world who go and find the money. It's really important to always make sure you're checking your statements after you get a payment. So I've had a song played, I know I've registered my work, and I get my first royalty check. That's great. Or that payment goes directly into my bank account these days. But it's really important to start looking at what you were paid for. Because you've registered all of your songs, but have you checked to make sure you were paid for all your songs? It's also really interesting to note, why is one song more popular in this country than in this country? Sometimes those things make sense. Sometimes it's because there's royalties missing. And that's why it's always important to check your royalty statement and ask questions about your payments. So we have a song. It's called I Love You. And there are 600 songs called I Love You. I'm never going to get paid. What's going to happen? And I wrote I Love You with four other songwriters. How do I make sure that I get paid and those other three songwriters get paid? Start your Excel spreadsheet tomorrow. Once you get a whole catalog in a career, yes, there's sophisticated databases that can help you out with this. But your best tool in the next early stages of your career is going to be that Excel spreadsheet. When you go into the studio and you write a song, do not leave until you decide what every songwriter on that song is going to get paid. The number one reason that songwriters do not get paid is because they've had a great creative session, they love the song, but they never talk about the business side. Tip number two for today, and it's as important as tip number one, was make sure that you get confirmation from all of your co-writers on what the splits are going to be. Is it going to be Nashville style and there's four writers in the room and everybody gets 25%? We go and register that all with SOCAN and with CMRA and get paid. That's great. Sometimes you'll find situations where you feel that you've brought more in with a beat, with a track, with lyrics that were already written. And in some cases, it is understandable that the shares won't be equal. But make sure you're talking about it. Make sure you're agreeing to that. There's new types of software you can look at that actually you can exchange your splits through the software and then get that song registered. And the low-tech, easiest way to do it is to come to that agreement, leave the room, and then just email and keep those emails and put those splits into your spreadsheets. So I've joined SOCAN, and my name is John Smith. Once again, I wrote, I love you, and I'm never going to get paid because there's too many Joe Smiths in the world. Well, you are a very specific Joe Smith who has an individual number called an IPI that SOCAN will give you. Keep track of that. if you're really detailed in your co-writing with those other three songwriters, get their IPI. They may have given you their stage name, get their legal name too, and keep all that information in your spreadsheet. The worst thing that happens is if you register, all four of you register the song and you register 110% of the song, you may never get paid. You want to make sure you're registering 100% with all the songwriters, and that you are keeping track of that information. The IPI that you're given is like your fingerprint, and you're going to make sure that you are getting paid and not that other Joe Smith in Denmark. You're then going to register that song, and each song has its own fingerprint, and that's called an international standard work code. You'll receive that also from SOCAN. You keep it in your spreadsheet. It is going to make sure that the 610 different versions of I Love You get paid. They may all have been recorded five times, but the song's the same for that original song that you wrote. And that metadata, the International Standard Work Code, is going to make sure that you get paid for that song. So then you make a recording because you're the artist. You own the recording, you put it through a digital distributor, you're going to get something called the International Standard Recording Code. Once and again, it's the fingerprint for the recording. But then 2 years down the line, you do a different version of the same song. You change something and it's a different recording. That will have a new ISRC, but it's the same song there. So, know your metadata. Don't trust your manager or someone else to do it for you. They may take over the administration, but continue to check on it. Continue to check your royalty statements. Make sure that all your songs are registered and nothing's in conflict. That's going to make sure that you get the paycheck you deserve. Are there any questions on this before we move on to a couple final videos?
Not yet, but the stream is slightly delayed. How about we watch a video so that let you cough and get some water? I feel bad. I'm like, should I stop and let you?
No, it's fine. It's great. Sorry.
No.
To be coughing on you.
No problem.
So why don't we start? This is we launched an accelerator program 3 years ago. We're really pleased to have two Manitoba producers in the program this year. And this program started because we saw that there were a lack of women and women identifying songwriters and producers in the studio. And so this mentorship program provides the information that these producers need to further their career. They're already producing, and what we want to do is take them to the next level in their career over their 7-month accelerator. So let's hear from a number of our alum. I'm not hearing the sound.
Oops, let me do that again. Sorry. There's a special button that I need to push and I didn't prepare it. That is my bad. Okay, second time the charm.
Hi.
Hey, it's Rini.
Hi, my name is Camille Poliquin.
I'm Teddy.
I'm Brie Isabel.
It's your girl Denise Dion.
My name is Carmen L.
My name is Maya.
Lisa Patterson here.
I'm Alex Bekovsky, otherwise known as Fiora.
My name is Sunsun.
Hi, my name is Isabel Banos, and I was a participant in the Women in the Studio.
Women in the Studio this past year.
Being an independent artist, it was important for me to learn everything possible about the music industry.
From the business side of things, the technical side of things, the creative side of things, the marketing side of things.
The mentors and the collaborators of the program, I feel so lucky to have been able to be
on calls with people who I really admire.
Just how diverse the different panels were. Across the board, they covered all the bases, and a lot of those panelists I reached out to and have been building those relationships ever since.
It was all a big eye-opener.
It has been so instrumental for me in progressing and in developing with my production skill, and really instill that confidence that we all need to really, you know, keep ourselves motivated and you know, reassuring ourselves that, you know, we're doing the right thing and we're in the right field.
And of course, the best reason of all, collaborating with fellow female producers. This was the biggest draw for me.
There's just so much that I've learned in the past year, and being able to put all that knowledge into action, into practice, has completely skyrocketed my career in a way that I would have never imagined.
Along the way, I signed my first co-publishing deal with Concord Music Group out of Nashville. I got some of my first cuts and sync placements as a producer. And one major highlight was meeting one-on-one with one of my songwriting and production idols, Alex Hope.
This led to so many cool opportunities for me, including but not limited to working with Linda Perry, who is a baller, as well as Splice. I actually put out a pack with them as a result.
Being in the program with primarily electronic producers, as a producer of primarily acoustic musics, I had this insight that if I could integrate those two worlds, I could bring something really unique to a specialized niche. And the results of that work can be heard on a recent single that I produced for Andrea Florian that's out, and several EPs coming up.
I've gotten sync licenses. I just did the music for the first season of a new TV show, which I had never done before. When I look back on this year, it feels surreal, and so much of that was because of the Women in the Studio program.
And I really do feel like there's now a connection and through the program, and that I could reach out to them for support or advice or anything, you know, musical career related. I really feel like I have found new allies in my musical career in them, so I'm extremely thankful.
My one-on-one with Linda Perry, which led me to create an album that ended up on the Polaris Prize shortlist, DNA Activation from Witch Prophet. I also got signed to High Priestess Publishing.
After the program, this company called CCS Rights Management reached out as they were looking for female producers and invited me to a camp where I was able to work with other creatives in the music industry. Me and artist Miles Costello ended up working on a song called Sangria that ended up coming out. I'm still working on the producing stuff, still making beats, and recently landed a placement on new Netflix series Jenny of Georgia. Also on the artist side, I go by Maya's Diary and have amassed over 10 million streams in 2020, which I'm extremely grateful for.
Thank you again, Women in the Studio Program, Music Publishers Canada.
Thank you to everyone over at Music Publishers Canada. Thank you to Music Publishers Canada and the Women in the Studio Program for making that happen.
I feel so, so grateful. Thank you for everything. It was an amazing journey. I mean, if I could take it again, I would. 100%.
To all the women that are producers, engineers, and I just encourage us to keep, you know, forming this community and growing every single day.
You know, we've all come through this together, and we kind of have this bond and this like kind of new family that we've started. And so I look forward to seeing what all of you do in the future.
So I look forward to seeing what everyone else is working on. And I hope we get to sit in a room at some point soon.
And to all of the future participants out there in the Women in the Studio program, enjoy it, soak it in. Your brain will be a sponge.
I wish the best of luck to the 2021 Women in the Studio program. You're gonna have so much fun.
Thank you, Music Publishers Canada.
Thanks for showing that. Makes me smile every time I see it. The Women in Studio Accelerator is open to producers, songwriters from across Canada. And as I said, there's two from Winnipeg this time around, and we're really loving that. The bios on all of the producers are on our website. So if you have somebody who's starting a project and is really looking for an amazing producer, new producer, you might want to take a look at the work of this group and potentially look at partnering and hiring them. And for you producers in the audience, we will be doing our fourth intake next March. So watch our socials and watch our website, and Music Manitoba will promote it too. And we'll hope a few of you will apply. So do we have any questions?
We do. We have a question from Matt. Do you have any tips for a Canadian songwriter pursuing an American publisher?
One, I would ask, why are you pursuing an American publisher? There's lots of great Canadians, but you know, there are many amazing publishers. It's all around networking. It is around putting yourself out there, making sure that you're branding yourself as a songwriter and as a producer. In our Women in the Studio Accelerator over the last year, we provided advice on branding on all the different platforms, because as routinely the publishers would be out there in your community, and now they can't be to the same extent. So they're watching things on TikTok. They're watching things on the streaming services. They're digging deep into the data and trying to find that songwriter, producer, beatmaker who's really out there. I would also talk to your community. So talk to other songwriters and to other producers about who they've been talking to, about who they've been working with, because a reference from another songwriter with a publisher is going to be one of your best ways to connect.
Right. So maybe don't look for an American publisher, look for a Canadian publisher who works in the US or has resources there.
Yeah. And there's lots of them, and they are watching you everywhere you are. So make sure you're being seen, and make sure you're working with other writers. And don't just work with the same writers all the time and say, I'm going to the studio with the same people. Mix it up and collaborate with new people, because that's going to increase your chances of being found too.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I have a question. So let's say you're watching this video and you realize you don't have a song registered, or you haven't registered your songs yet to receive royalties. How far back can you collect royalties that you may have missed out on?
It really depends on the territory and on the revenue pool. It's often 3 years for performance rights organizations, although other organizations will go much further back. So you really need to talk in Canada to SOCAN CMRA, see how far back they can go. It is better to register the song as soon as it's written than to wait, because it's a really good point. You do risk losing revenue if you don't get that song registered.
Right. And so usually what I'll do when I'm doing a co-write is we finish the co-write, we finish the split, we get the numbers from each other, and we register it while we're still on the Zoom call. So we don't forget, we're all on the same page, and it just makes everything easy. So if something ever happens, you don't have to like rush to get everything covered. So
exactly. There's a lot of people too, we'll just do a calendar date once a month, and they'll say, this is my Saturday morning where I'm registering all my songs. And you just can't miss that calendar date.
Yeah, I don't trust myself.
I like yours. That's the smartest piece of advice I've actually heard, is to do it right in the room. And mm-hmm. It's the best case scenario, but a lot of people don't do that.
Right. Yeah. And there's no like awkward, like, so the song's making money now, and we need to register it. Can I only give you 20% since I wrote most of the song? Like, it gets a little weird. So if you keep it right up front and you're fair, it actually can be quite quite of a good like a networking tool to be.
Yeah, and don't feel awkward about the conversation. Everybody in the room is going to get paid if you all register. So you just need to get comfortable with that conversation and have it every time you're in the writing room.
Absolutely.
And when they were not in the writing room, because you're not right now, and there's files floating around, make sure you do it at the end of the writing process. So declare an end to the writing process and get it registered.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Great. It doesn't look like we have any other questions. So with that, I guess we can wrap up. Thank you so much, Margaret. This has been a fantastic presentation, and I think it answers, it always like answers a lot of questions that I have that I'll, even though I've been to tons of these presentations, I'm just like, oh yeah, I forgot about that, or, oh, that's good to know, or you have a well-rounded presentation that kind of answers everything. So thank you so much for taking the time to be here.
Well, thanks so much for the invitation. I really wish we can do this in person sometime soon.
Yeah, soon. We'll make it happen. But we'll definitely have you back in one way or another, maybe to talk about, you know, songwriting and stuff like that.
And sync. We can do a whole session on sync. So.
Yes, I'm going to write that down, sync, so I don't forget. So I can definitely have you back. Great. So with no other questions, thank you to everyone for joining us for this evening for the first On Track Indigenous Music Business Basics series. Tune in next week to learn about show booking etiquette and communications. If you want to learn more about the whole series, you can go to indigenousmusic.ca/ontrack. Again, thank you, Margaret, and Music Publishers Canada, apologies, for taking the time to teach us about this and for being such an excellent resource and an organization for musicians and songwriters across Canada. If you have any questions about royalties or music registration, you can email me at ashley@manitobamusic.com. And I hope that with that, you have a wonderful evening, and I hope to see you next time. Merci, and good night.
Good night.